morning, everybody. Thank you for coming up to this early hour. And I'm very grateful to, especially grateful to Sonia Knecht and Jürgen Ziebert to invite me to to present my work today at this creative morning. The next 20 minutes, we will explore together how to read the brushwork in Asian calligraphy to get a better understanding of the art and its creation and meaning. I'm going to approach the subject with the eyes of a typographer. Nevertheless, this is only one way of interpreting calligraphic characters. Before I start, I'd briefly like to introduce myself. My name is Toshiya Izumo, and I grew up near Mount Fuji in Japan. I studied social sciences in Tokyo. After graduation, I came to Berlin to study visual communication. And then I graduated with a diploma thesis on the differences between Western and Japanese typography, ranging from their history to micro typography, supervised by Eric Spiekermann. Since then, I've been working as a graphic designer at Aiden Spiekermann, with a specialization in pictograms, illustrations, packagings for customers such as Bosch. Besides my job, I'm dedicated on my own design and research projects. The subject I'm going to talk about today is one of these projects. It is a direct continuation and further development of my diploma thesis. But before we dive into the anatomy of brush strokes, I'd like to shortly introduce you to the importance of calligraphy in everyday Japan. People who have already been to Japan and walked through one of its major cities will have noticed the great number of calligraphy exhibitions all over. You find them not only in museums and galleries, but also in cafes, bookstores, department stores, and all other sorts of places. Most of the calligraphy exhibitions are usually well frequented. And to my astonishment, there are quite a lot of people who are looking at the artworks for a long time. Much the same as Western people here who contemplate paintings or other artworks from all possible periods. When I was still living in Japan, I never understood what my country fellow countrymen see in calligraphy. What is it that they read in this art form made of nothing but paper and ink? And how do they enjoy it? From these observations arose the question, what people actually see in calligraphy? I started to take a deeper look. The question of what people see in calligraphy was a starting point for further questions that I want to answer directly. Can calligraphy be apprehended as art? Yes. One can contemplate it and take it in, but there are also other types of calligraphy characters, for example, letters. Does the viewer read and understand the content of calligraphy? Yes. If they can read the characters, most viewers will at least partially understand them, but most likely not all of them. What does calligraphy talk about? Calligraphy in Japan usually contains poems, sayings, messages, or stories. Does one understand their meaning? The average visitor won't understand everything because they can't read all the characters. For that purpose, there are professional critics, researchers, and professors who decode and classify the artworks. Why do people visit calligraphy nonetheless? Calligraphy exhibition nonetheless? It's simplest because it's fun. Of course, from that insight follows the question, how to have fun there. This question was the reason to study the subject further and to share my result in this presentation. I hope that I can open up new perspectives and inspire new ideas, especially for listeners who are interested in typography or design fonts themselves. One way to enjoy calligraphy could be to use its history and the history of characters as a key to come closer to its signification. Historical knowledge and an understanding of context can allow to analyze an artwork and possibly find out that it has been influenced by calligrapher A and lettering style B. Perhaps the artist tried to combine both and modernize at the same time. Thus, a good knowledge of historical developments are one method to find contemplation in calligraphy and understand it. However, the history of calligraphy goes back about 3,500 years, and there are uncountable important works and calligraphers that one should know. This mammoth task would not only take a long time, it would also be very difficult for foreigners to collect resources and information to read and to understand them. But fortunately, there is another method which you can read and apply rather quickly. It allows you to develop the right feeling for the meaning of strokes and lines. The method which I want to introduce you today is how to read Asian brush strokes. Please don't sleep yet. It doesn't take long. So, naturally, the most important tool for the creation of the character is brush. It is made from diverse materials besides all kinds of animal hairs. Nowadays, synthetic materials are widely used for its production. The different materials result the different degree of hardness and resiliency of the brush. Furthermore, every hair type possesses different suction qualities and retains the ink in its own way. How you use a brush also affects the final result of the strokes. The brush hairs can be roughly divided in three parts, as you can see here in the enlarged image. If you use only the tip of the brush, stroke becomes monotonous because all the strokes have the same thickness. Using the brush hairs in their full length, on the other hand, you can create all possible variations of strokes from thin to fat lines. Of course, there are advantages and disadvantages to every technique. Different brush sizes also result in a different density of strokes. The hair length is also important for carving and stroke widths. Solid ink is made from lampblack and binding material, which must be ground with water on an inkstone until you achieve the desired consistency. Depending on the consistency, you can get different results. The more watery the ink is, the more it seeps in the paper. The strokes become brighter and paper shines through. Moreover, the brush slides easily on the paper compared to using thicker ink. Needless to say, the sort of paper one uses is also very important. The paper can be rather yellowish or whitish, rather rough or fine. Depending on what paper you use, the lines become thicker or thinner because the ink is absorbed to a different degree. The combination of different brushes, paper types, and ink consistencies make for a wide variety of possible results. If you move the brush swiftly, the line becomes scratchy. The upper line shows the result if the brush was drawn slowly at first and only faster at the end of the stroke. In contrast, the lower line depicts what happens if the brush is moved at steady pace. The specific characteristics of the strokes are also achieved by the different angles of brush. As you can see here in this picture, the beginning of a stroke reveals how the line was drawn and which course the creator's hand took. On its way across the paper, the brush will change angles many times. As you can see in this example, it gives the viewer a good idea of how a certain stroke was drawn. Lines are almost always drawn one after another. This is why it is possible to tell from the end of one line and the starting point of the next which line has been drawn first and which subsequently. The principle of stroke widths and depths can also be found in inscriptions engraved in stones. Previously, these were more official and had more authority than all things written on paper. Numerous emperors and influential people used these calligraphic inscriptions to eternalize and justify their achievement, for example, in a gravestone. If you examine Asian inscriptions more closely, you will notice that the depth of characters varies. Western inscriptions, on the other hand, are almost always evenly deep. This visual effect is a distinctive feature of Asian calligraphy and also affects the creation of characters on paper. Sculptors have tried to interpret the transcription process from written to engraved characters. The different character depths in stones or wood are interpreted the following way. Thin lines are curved rather flatly, thick lines deeper according to their intensity. Bright shades are less stressed. Dark hues, on the contrary, are curved even deeper. Thus, one has always tried to create the top view on a line like a side view. Here is another graphic to show how the brush work figures into the creation of depths. If the brush is pushed harder onto the paper, that part of the line is interpreted as deeper. The same applies to the opposite. Faster and lighter brush strokes make the line seem shallower. Some Japanese calligraphers say that they don't write, but carve or cut on paper. Instead of drawing or writing strokes, they consider their whole way of working as carving, and realizing that idea is the center of their calligraphy technique. Twisting the tip of the brush is another way to influence the result. If the brush is slanted, the line becomes wider. If the brush is twisted in a curve, its hairs are twisted as well. As opposed to soft hair, hard hair quickly moves back into its original state. The occurring friction force makes the line become scratchy. I'd like to demonstrate this effect in two examples. If the brush is moved slowly to the end of the line, or if its hairs are long and soft, you can draw a uniform line till the end, as can be seen in the left characters. In contrast, the right line was drawn with a hard brush. This is why the end of this line is scratchy. The hairs couldn't stay twisted till the end of the line. Opening and closing the brush hairs by pressing them down vertically is another way to create variations. The more the brush is pressed down, the more its hairs move apart. This way, one can achieve structural changes and more subtleties. As you can see here, the left stroke was drawn without vertical power. For the middle stroke, the calligrapher uses a half-depressed brush. The last example shows us how the appearance changes if the brush is depressed completely. What also becomes apparent is the scratchy effect. In the middle stroke, only the edges are scratchy, while the center of the stroke looks soaked with ink. In contrast, the stroke on the right hand is all scratchy. The difference is due to the openness grade of the brush hairs. Thus, with a half-depressed brush, only the outer hairs lose their bond, while the brush hairs at the center continue to apply ink evenly. In conclusion, I'd like to demonstrate the different techniques by an example. Therefore, I'll summarize the different methods and their effects again. The brush size is slant. The difference is in depth when depressing. And the pace of the brush stroke creates a different widths and density grades of the strokes. The writing pace also affects the density and can cause scratchy effect. Different angles of the brush position make for diverse stroke forms. Its traces can be found especially at the beginning and the end of a stroke. Due to historical inscriptions in form of engraving, the stroke depth is also relevant on paper. Blurring and scratching are other design principles used in calligraphy. How these techniques are applied, I want to show in three characters which all signify the beautiful word flower. In the first character, you can notice that a big brush was used and its hairs were depressed quite strongly on the paper. As a consequence, the stroke is quite broad. The frayed end suggests that the brush must have been rather stiff. Otherwise, this spot would be rounded off. As the scratch marks show, the brush wasn't moved quickly, but the character was written rather slowly. The overall impression of the character is bold and solid. But simultaneously, the brush stroke lacks diligence and subtlety, as one can see in the rather coarse edges. In contrast here, the brush was moved wildly at first, shown by the coarse edges at the first line of the character. A mid-size brush was used to draw a line from the top right to the bottom left. Then it quickly went up again to the top right and then again slowed down from the top right to the bottom left. The same movement is repeated once again. The second element of this character, the stroke started with the tip of the brush. After a turn, the brush was depressed on paper, stopped once towards the end, and pulled up to the right quickly. The overall impression here is quite wild, but multifaceted. The combination of quick brush strokes and varying stroke widths gives the impression of a dynamic and bold brush movement. The last character, meaning flower, was started thoroughly at first, but after the first turn, the stroke was pulled to the right very suddenly. Then it was continued slowly once again. Then the brush was flying almost to the end of the stroke and literally danced in the air. That way, a fleeting and fragile overall impression is created. However, the strokes seem to be flowing and dancing beautifully, creating an image of enchanting cherry blossom, for instance. Finally, let's have a look at this artwork, which allows us to retrace all the techniques what I have just presented to you. The work is called Jijojo by the Chinese calligrapher Kaiso and was created 777 AD. It has a format of approximately 28 by 755 centimeters. If you saw such a large artwork on exhibition, maybe you would become scared. Maybe. But don't panic. If you interpret the characters step by step, you can enjoy even such a complex artwork. To make it short, you can read the artwork the following way. At the outset, the calligrapher's hand moved relatively calm, slowly, and with a continuous stroke widths. But already in the second line, he emphasized the strokes a little bit more, like music building up and getting louder. The strokes continue, sometimes more pronounced, but still going calm and steady. All of a sudden, a bold and remarkably bigger character comes up in the middle of the sentence. and certain single characters are more enhanced. The artwork is getting louder. The second row is almost the end of the artwork. The first two lines, tender and six strokes, are combined. In the third line, a huge character appears, written with thick brush strokes and quick move. The music once speaks of the climax, the highest of the artwork. It is followed by a dynamic character and a chaotic part, sometimes bolder, sometimes faster, and sometimes very emotional. The artwork can be read like a piece for an orchestra. All sorts of characters and techniques are mixed in this part, and it could shake your interpretation and maybe your feelings. This way, you can comprehend step by step how the artwork was drawn. It is almost as if you could watch the calligrapher compose the characters one after another and give vent to your feelings and your interpretation while taking in the artwork. Thus, you can enjoy a calligraphy exhibition in the same way as you can have fun at a classical music concert. Letting sounds or characters sink in, you will actively create an overall impression of the artwork and also answers to your own interpretation and momentary mood. So, the next time, if you see someone spending a long time at a calligraphy exhibition, you know exactly what that person is doing there. He's contemplating the artwork. Maybe an imaginary brush flies around his head. And certainly, my short presentation will allow all of you present today to have fun at calligraphy exhibitions and enjoy them with different eyes and new perspectives. You don't have to be an expert for calligraphy. It is enough to give a little more attention to the subtleties. That brings me to the end of my presentation. Thank you for listening.